Woo!
Did Nick just woo? Was that Chris?
That was.
Should we keep it a mystery, Chris?
That was the Nick of the day, but the Chris of the night who wooed. Which
the hero
one are
that,
we, though?
That Gotham needs, but not the one that it deserves. All right, you ready?
I suck them.
I thought you liked puzzle games.
Fuck you.
The year of 2014 is coming to a close. We're so sad about that. But we are happy to point out our best games of the year. I'm Nick, senior producer of Press Play TV, and I'm joined by the fine gentleman that I was joined by last year, Chris and Pete from How Do I Jump. How you guys doing?
Hello. Yay. Again. It's been a whole year. We've become wiser and smarter. Wiser and smarter.
I don't know that either of those
and
are true.
And that just proves it.
That's how wise and smart we are.
Yeah. But we definitely played a lot of games, so we can comment on that either way. Yeah, because this is our game of the year 2014 deliberations. Just so you guys at home know, we are going to be doing 5 days worth of this. I know, it's a lot. But every day we're going to be coming out with a different set of categories on best different types of games from this year. So make sure to keep tuning in. We are going to kick this thing off, but a quick little opening piece, just because last year there was a little bit of confusion, you know, people in the comments and stuff. Where I just want to, you know, let you guys know what the rules are for us for choosing these things. So the ones that we sort of decided on was you have to have played the game that you choose. You can't use an early access game because we're talking about a game that had to be released this year. So you can't also do games that were re-released this year, like remastered editions and stuff like that. And episodes of games that haven't released their whole season, like the Game of Thrones game, the Tales from the Borderlands game, can't be chosen for best game stuff. They cannot be chosen for best game stuff, but they can be chosen for best moment stuff, or things like that. So best WTF moment, I think, best, I don't know, we'll find out when we get there, I guess. But yeah, those are the rules, and so we're going to kick this thing off. We have, I think, 7 categories today, and the first one is sort of a pretty big one, so let's do this. Best action game of 2014. It's always been best action game at the start, and I feel like that's such a big category to start out with. But
start with a bang.
Yeah. All right, so we usually do it like this. We will each say, without comment, what our choices. Each of us has brought one choice to the table. We each say our choice, and then after that, we each make a short argument for our choice, and then after that, we sort of narrow it down. So, we're going to do it in order here of Chris, Pete, me. So, Chris, you got the first honors. What is your best action game?
The spotlight. Mm. Okay.
Love it.
Right. All right, well, I mean, for those who know me, this isn't too much of a surprise, but I have to give this game credit because, one, it actually changed quite a few things and probably is the most mechanically sound of the series, in my opinion. I also apologize in advance, Nick, because the comments will probably be everyone threatening me with death when they hear this. But looking at it, it also made it a little bit easier for newer people to get on into it and actually pulled a lot of friends of mine who weren't into the series into it. I'm going to have to say Dark Souls 2 for best action game.
Nice. Mm.
Yes, I was very happy with the game. I think it's the most mechanically sound of the series. Kill me if you must, commenters. But I quite enjoyed it.
Destroy him! All right, well, I immediately, when I looked at this category, the first thing came to mind was action and a game that is just fun to jump around and play and explosions and just does ridiculous action so well is Sunset Overdrive. I went with.
Nice.
Because,
did you play that?
Yeah. Nice. Yes, I did. I played it for the free day, and then I think Wegman picked it up and I played it more at his place. And it's just, I cannot define that game more than action. That's it. And,
all right.
And funny, but action mostly.
Yeah, I didn't play Sunset Overdrive, but I have a feeling that might have been my choice if I had. But My choice, sort of like the most obvious choice you could ever make, but I really liked it. Call of Duty Advanced Warfare.
I knew it.
Everyone can get mad at me. All my indie cred is gone. But Call of Duty does some good action stuff. No, I mean, they made a lot of good changes this year. So,
you know, they actually did. I was on that episode. There was actually a lot of good stuff done to that series.
So yeah,
I'm sorry. I thought you wanted to defend it without us commentating.
Yeah, I did. So.
Oh, sorry. Okay.
let's do our thing. So this is the way that it goes from here. We have three great choices: Dark Souls, Sunset Overdrive, and Call of Duty. Now we're going to go down the line, and we're each going to make our sort of, you know, individual argument. So, Chris, why is Dark Souls 2 the best action game? You already sort of said it, but say it again, I guess.
Yeah, right. Like, yeah, like, well, like I said before, I think the biggest thing for this one is it made it not the easiest, well, according to how the Souls community looks at it, but in my opinion, not the easiest thing, but it lightened up a little bit to the point where it actually pulls more people into it. It explains it a little bit better in that fact, and just, you know, when you go through the whole Dark Souls series itself, there's so much heart-pumping moments from what happens into it, where it's like, oh my god, do I swing now? Do I block? Do I parry? Do I dare open up that door? And it's just, the adrenaline that pumps through it just, it got me like not really any other action game that I played this year, really. Although, while obviously, of course, Call of Duty is quite intense, I will say that, and Sunset as well, but I couldn't get the kind of just pumping and just the changes that came in Dark Souls 2, and it's just so much smoother than the rest of the series that I couldn't find anywhere else.
And I was going to go with totally if you just haven't played Bayonetta 2 yet, is what I'll say.
Well, you know, of course, I don't own a Wii U. That would have
I can't find a better description of action than this year than Sunset Overdrive. It took what a game is, like literally making fun of mechanics of games, like calling out tropes and tutorials and just ridiculous guns. Insomniac can just make things that are fun to blow up and run around and explode. And there's freaking 8-player co-op online, and there are so many explosions.
Okay.
For sheer explosion to moment ratio, I think Sunset wins.
That is a good point. Explosions are important. My thing for Call of Duty, there's a decent amount of explosions in Call of Duty too.
There are a fair amount of explosions in Call of Duty.
There's also amount of quick time segments, yeah. And parts where
I will not say I very much enjoyed the new Call of Duty also. That might be coming up for me later on. However, I think Sunset had better action still.
Yeah, I mean, Call of Duty, the problem for me with the action in Call of Duty is that you don't actually have a lot of room for expression. Like, because it is, it's like a corridor, and you walk down it and shoot the guys, and you could choose the order in which you shoot them. But other than that, it's really, you know, you're not doing anything cool. So the thing about Dark Souls and Sunset is you have so much room to, like, customize your guy and, like, do all these different things, you know, and achieve your task in a different way. So I am going to bow out for Call of Duty.
I will say that Dark Souls 2 is one of the only games in the Souls series I actually put a significant amount of time into. And it, like what you were saying before, Chris, of it being approachable, I did very much. There's that sweat dripping from your hands tactical action in Dark Souls, and of jumping back and forth, of really reading your enemy, and like getting that last second dodge to the side, and that one slice in, and then dodge to the side again. And I don't know. It is good, but I just can't get Sunset out of my head. I'm sorry.
Yeah. Look, the thing with Sunset is it is a lot more, and I will actually bow out to Sunset, but there is there is a lot more in-your-face action in Sunset. However, from the cutscenes I've listened to, that humor with the fourth wall breaking really started to annoy me around the end of the game. Like, it was just so, guys, wasn't that funny? Wink, wink, nudge, nudge. And at the end, I was like, please just shut the hell up and finish the game. Because I don't care anymore. But yeah.
I did not put Sunset in for my funniest game. I agree with you on that one.
It got annoying. But I, once again, though, the action and explosions. Oh my god, you lose count in Sunset, though. You really.
Especially to go online. Oh my god, so
I haven't
much
seen online either. Also, that's just from single player. I'm talking from
freaking
so,
yeah. Chaos. It's chaos online. I think it's called Chaos Squad. So it's there. You go.
Oh well, there you go then. But yeah, I bow out. I say Sunset Overdrive. It is.
Sunset Overdrive, the first winner of 2014, best action game. Yeah, I probably would have to.
Everyone hates us.
I mean, if I was going to choose between Dark Souls and Sunset, I'd probably do the same thing, if only because Sunset is more of like a bombastic action.
Yeah.
And Dark Souls, I feel like there are other categories here that Dark Souls might have.
Oh, you know, don't worry, it'll show up. It'll show up.
I don't think Sunset's going to be showing up again today, but it did action very, very well.
Damn right it did.
So the next category on the list, moving on forward, we have Best Adventure Game. Best Adventure Game. So the thing about Adventure Game, last year we sort of made a change. We used to do it where it was only adventures in the sense that it you know, a point-and-click adventure or like a Adventure Nouveau, like, you know, Walking Dead-style adventure game. But we opened that up to mean action adventure. So our winner last year, just to remind everyone, was Tomb Raider. So, you know, that it's sort of like that more loose interpretation of what adventure means, just for everybody at home. So that being said, let's move on to Chris's choice for best adventure game.
I'm going to do it proper now, but my choice for best adventure game is first, why didn't we all buy it? And second, it's D4.
Okay. D4, Dark Dreams Don't Die.
Damn, that's right. It is.
If we're going to talk about adventure, I define adventure as walking over a cresting hilltop and just very much enjoying. It is very to do with the scenery to me, adventure games, of exploring new areas, like seeing, adventuring to new unknown places, really getting lost and just walking around and enjoying exploring and adventuring in this world. So this game may also pop up once or twice, but I'm going to go with Dragon Age Inquisition.
Nice.
It just, I loved walking around all those areas. They're all so varied, and I love walking around.
Okay, so my choice is also D4.
Oh!
Yeah.
There it is!
I just started playing that game a few days ago, actually, and it is amazing.
Isn't it? Isn't
it?
It
is really
great.
Amazing. So, yeah, I guess, like, just because to keep the show sort of rolling along, let's keep our arguments to, or like our, you know, things where we discuss why it's the best game, like, let's keep that to the second part, and, you know, when we say our names, like, we'll just do the name of the game and move on, sort of like how The Jump does it.
Yeah,
gotcha. So, that being said, now that we're in the second part, Chris, why is D4 the best adventure game of 2014?
How do you explain Dark Dreams Don't Die? Okay, well, the dude, from what I know, is a detective who essentially has the ability to hop into, like, memories and the past of people to try and solve his wife's murder. Does that not sound awesome? It is so ridiculous. It is by the Swery 65, in case anyone's wondering out there. I just love the characters Swery makes in all of his series, really. They're just so over the top. And it's interesting because it's either the main character who's absolutely insane, or in D4's example, the rest of the cast that's also insane. It's, oh my god, it's so just good. Everything, just the characterization, the stuff that goes down, the twists and the turns to the whole mystery of it. I just really hope we actually get more episodes of it in the future. I wish Swery much success in the future.
All right.
Yeah.
Pete, Dragon Age Inquisition.
I will pretty much quickly bow out for Dragon Age Inquisition. Just one for the double whammy of the nominating for this game, but also because adventuring into that ridiculous realm of how this game has been described to me. I haven't played it, but just it's very interesting of adventuring into that. I'm sure it's you want to explore the next moment in a whole new way.
I won't go into spoilers, obviously, but when you meet his cat is one of the greatest things ever.
Are you talking about his, like, quote-unquote cat?
Yes, yes.
Okay. Yeah.
I didn't want to spoil, awesome. For those who haven't seen, yeah. That meeting is just, it was just, at that point you were like, what is even going to happen now after this?
So yeah, I mean, that game, it really won me over. Like, I've never played a Kinect video game, and I really don't even really respect Kinect video games. But yeah, D4 did a decent job of being like a point and click with your hand, you know, on the Kinect. And for that, I really respect what they did. But also, it's just an insane, yeah, it's a lot like Deadly Premonition in the way that, you know, the guy actually does do a weird thing with his coffee. I don't know if you got to that part, Chris, where he,
yeah,
you
no, sit at the thing, I have, yeah,
and you open all the fortune cookies by smashing the table. Like, it's just really dumb.
I love those fortune cookies so much. His yeah. face at them is amazing.
His face is so good. And I just want to point out one moment from D4 where he's in a conversation with the guy, his friend, who's like a detective, and they're both eating clam chowder. And just at the beginning, they grab oyster crackers and start cracking them over the clam chowder. And just as the conversation continues, nobody's looking at their chowder, but the bowl is just becoming filled with a mountain of oyster cracker like crumbs. It is amazing.
And they just keep going.
Yeah.
It's fantastic.
So for moments like that, that is the adventure game that wins for 2014 for our best adventure game. All right, D4.
Woo! Check it out. D4. Good stuff.
So moving on, we have another category here that just made it in right at the end. It almost got booted there, but we are going to reboot this one for the best reboot of 2014.
Oh,
Chris.
I see what you did. for my best reboot, I have to say Gauntlet.
Nice. Wow, I totally forgot about that.
I know, everyone did.
Gauntlet, what was the full title of that?
Was it just, I can't remember.
I think it was just Gauntlet.
I about to say, maybe. Okay. I'll check that right now, but go on.
My best reboot was Wolfenstein: The New Order.
And my best reboot is also Wolfenstein: The New Order.
I'll probably wind up backing down. I'll say that right now, but
no, that was a good surprise.
It's a good
yeah.
choice, yeah. All right, so Chris, why is Gauntlet the best reboot?
Right, it's like it is indeed fact called Gauntlet. I just looked it up quickly. The reason why it's the best reboot is for those of you who have played the original Gauntlet, we all know the tropes of it: wizard needs food badly, that stuff. Everything is in this game from that, to the point of you can destroy food from your friends so they can't heal, and just all of the friendship destroy mechanics of the whole Gauntlet series are all together in one, reimagined with better graphics, just the ridiculous dungeon crawling, fighting huge bosses, infinite amounts of enemies, stealing each other's gold, buying stuff, pushing each other into traps, all of it's still there, all of it's there to ruin your friendships. But yeah, I might wind up backing down because Wolfenstein is an absolutely ridiculous game. So,
yeah, well, it's interesting that we brought that up because we were discussing before that Wolfenstein is a game that it goes along with Gauntlet also. I haven't thought about Wolfenstein. I haven't thought about Gauntlet in so long. Like, except for those classic jokes of, like, if I think like a Doom clone or something like that for Wolfenstein, or if I think Wizard Needs Food Badly or something like that for Gauntlet. But in general, of playing the, like, I never thought there would be a new Wolfenstein game. I never thought there would be a new Gauntlet game. especially after some of the Gauntlet games that came out after, I did not enjoy those runestones. I just think it reinvigorated, it rebooted it in the way it did. I mean, I'm sure Gauntlet did this also, where it brings back that old school when video games loved being stupid and explodey and shooty, fucking dual-wielding miniguns and punching Hitler, like shooting Nazis again, like just the fun stuff of video games. It just brought me back to an age, and knowing that you guys know I'm not that nostalgic of a person, was nice.
Yeah, I mean, Wolfenstein for me, it's got all the really dumb stuff. You can dual wield every weapon, as far as I know.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And it wants you to dual wield them, too.
But, oh, you should.
the thing that really got me about that game was its, like, conveyance of story through the first person. And, like, I didn't realize that Machine Games, the guy who did this, were all ex-Starbreeze. But, yeah, Starbreeze is a studio that I've loved forever. And, you know, specifically because of that, like, they're... The Darkness was really what you know got me to them, but they also did Riddick, and I think they did something else. Oh, they did Syndicate, which are all games that I like adore.
They are,
and yeah, Wolfenstein you know, had a good mix of, like, you know, that really dumb stuff that they would have, but also these really interesting mechanics, like, you know, trying to take out the, you know, the leader guy so he wouldn't call the cops or whatever, or call the cops, so he wouldn't call in reinforcements.
Oh, the cops are coming! The cops are coming!
Quickly, the Nazi cops, quickly!
So, yeah, I mean, just a lot of cool, like, in a reboot sense, like, a lot of cool mechanics that they sort of layered on top of Wolfenstein while still allowing it to feel like Wolfenstein in a certain degree, like, that is pretty impressive to me. Also, the part where you have a nightmare about the actual Wolfenstein was pretty great.
Right, yeah, that was fantastic. At one point, the best thing about that game to me was Blazkowicz's inner war voice. When he goes into that mode, was just really, really cool sounding, in my opinion, just when he has, like, the whole reflection on his own character.
Yeah.
Like, I didn't expect a story out of Wolfenstein of all goddamn things, let's face it.
Yeah, I mean, he's actually sort of like a, you know, you sort of identify with him because he's actually, like, really nice to, you know, the people around him. Like, he's not a dickhead, like, a meathead guy. He's, like, you know, he's trying to help these, like, soldiers who are really worried about, you know, the situations they're going into, and he's saying, like, you know, take 4 deep breaths and then, like, let him out or whatever. Like, he's being, like, a good role model, sort of, in a weird way.
Yeah, it's kind of odd because it's, like, a super soldier with a personality.
Yeah, that actually goes a really long way to me liking that game more, and it's such a small touch. Like, they didn't need to do it, but it was great that they did. So, yeah, moving on to the next category, we are almost halfway through. Best RPG of 2014.
So, I mean,
everyone knows my answer.
I was about to say, I mean, like, come on, we know where this is going to go at this point. But
just say it, Chris. Should we say it together?
Oh, let's do it on a count of three.
Okay.
One, two, three. Dragon Age Inquisition.
Dragon Age Inquisition.
Dark Souls 2.
Oh!
Damn.
No.
I obviously not did so Dark Souls 2 because I love it, but I gotta go Inquisition because, oh my god, that game did so many things.
Again, right. Right. Again, like the action category, you cannot play Dragon Age Inquisition without thinking this is a genius RPG. I love how they've adapted the RPG skills mechanics, where I know a bunch of years ago BioWare started to do that thing where they brought back, they had that annoying thing with skill systems before where you would just upgrade the skills and it would incrementally just increase, like, oh, it's a 2% chance, now it's a 2.5% chance, now it's a 3% chance. But now it's actual, like, gameplay effects. Like, my shot hits the problem from far away. If I upgrade it, it also makes them fall asleep now. If I shoot this person this way, if I combine this, like, actual gameplay skills instead of just stat incrementals. And I just love they started doing that. And just Dragon Age Inquisition is just ridiculously, just everything BioWare has done right, they are just putting in Inquisition. It's amazing.
Thank God for it, too. As much, and it really pains me that you said Dark Souls 2, Nick, damn it. It really does, because I love the series, I say Inquisition.
And we didn't get to bring this up before. I kept wanting to talk about this. The dialogue system in Inquisition is such a great advancement of the BioWare dialogue system that I can just walk up to somebody, and if I just stand there, they begin their dialogue, and I can get the quest and I can complete the quest without even talking to them, like pressing the button.
Cool.
Like, they
you really well done.
They begin talking to you, and then if you stay there for a little bit, like, it'll fade in the dialogue things at the bottom, and you can press A. Also, your party talks, and at point in times, you can talk to your party. If you click down R3, the little thing will come up at the bottom. And, like, they just – it's done so well, and they just zoom in slowly. There's no more of that weird Uncanny Valley freaking zoom in to everybody. It's like this nice, smooth transition, and it's just done so well.
It's also the fact of whichever party members, like, you put together, like, obviously they'll have different conversations and stuff, but as you actually venture more with a certain – bunch of people, they'll actually develop relationships and, like, become friendly or more heated towards the other people that they're with as well.
Right? Some people, BioWare does a great thing, bickering. They do bickering so well.
I love Dorian and Blackwall together are the best thing.
It's great because it's just that great idea that you don't, everyone in your party doesn't need to like each other, and they shouldn't like each other because they're all these ridiculously like very skilled people, and they're not going to get along.
Yeah. I mean, like basically between some of them, it's like complete racism against like their culture and everything. And they're just like, oh, well, you smell, or well, your beard's stupid looking. And they just start going nuts on each other. It's fantastic.
Yeah, so that's pretty, I mean, to be honest, I chose Dark Souls 2 because I haven't played Dragon Age. But, yeah. And I can't choose it. But I definitely agree that Dragon Age seems like it should win. I mean, Dark Souls is amazing, and it definitely is an RPG, but it's not as sort of extensive and like impressive as Dragon Age when you look at it. So I think I would go with Dragon Age also.
Don't worry, Dark Souls, you'll get your win. I promise you.
Someday. Even if we have to create a best Dark Souls 2 category, and Dark Souls 2 is the only possible thing, you will win something. All right, let's move on. Best Badass Enabler. That's a category we invented. I believe we invented it last year. Because video games, there's a lot of... I mean, if you've watched some of the videos from Press Play TV, you might know about what I think of games that sort of make you into a badass in certain scenarios. But I think it's a cool thing to have in a lot of games. And so, yeah, what's the game, Chris, that made you feel like the most of a badass?
I probably got the name of this thing wrong, but I'm going to throw it out there anyway. My best badass enabler is the Shade Strike from Shadows of Mordor.
Okay.
I probably got the right name wrong.
No, I'm with Chris. My best badass enabler was Shadow of Mordor.
Okay, it's a clean sweep. I also chose Shadow of Mordor. Even though I made a video that describes why the badass enabling in Shadow of Mordor is kind of stupid. But despite yes. that, I still enjoy playing it. So, yeah, best badass enabler. It certainly does make you feel like a badass.
Like that Shade Strike move, the fact that you teleport into a group of two guys in mid-conversation and one of them just suddenly has a sword in his head is just the greatest thing ever.
Yeah.
Like, I mean, hey, there's so much about that game, though. There's so much about that game that makes you feel like a badass. I mean, even if you're in, like, a regular combat scenario, just, like, fighting a whole giant group of guys and, like, you know, did you ever get the thing where, like, you need to block two guys at the same time, and if you double-tap Y, then the ghost guy comes out and blocks the second strike for
and
you?
And they just start throwing each other around. So good. It's such a brutal, like, obviously it's a combat similar to Arkham, but it's like so just brutal and just his moves and just fluidity of the whole situation. It's so good.
Yeah, I mean, that game is just insane. And the Nemesis stuff is amazing. And I mean, just being able to take those guys, you know, cross their names off a list, you know, killing them or whatever, it absolutely makes you feel like a badass. Like, in a way that other games really haven't been able to do, like, just because the worlds weren't as fleshed out. So... yeah, good on you, Shadow of Mordor. Did some cool stuff. Yeah.
Looking forward to a sequel.
Yeah. Best DLC is the next category. I have to admit that I didn't really play a lot of DLC this year, but Chris, take it away. I'm guessing I know what yours is.
Right. Oh, what? No, you're probably right. My best DLC was the final DLC of Dark Souls 2, The Ivory King.
Nice.
Mine was actually Diablo 3, Reaper of Souls.
Nice.
That's a good one.
So I'm going to say the only DLC that I think I played this entire year, even though it is good, Shadowrun Dragonfall.
Ooh, that is a good one as well, actually.
Yeah, that is technically DLC. That came out as a standalone.
You know, I don't actually know if it's a standalone or not.
I'm pretty sure it says DLC on it, but...
Yeah. It is DLC, but you can also buy it as a standalone.
Yeah.
Okay.
He is right, but yeah, no, it's... yeah. Look, all right, should I just hop on into this then, or...?
Yeah, do it. I mean, I don't need any convincing, I don't think. For anything Dark Souls 2, I'm going to believe is amazing, so...
Right.
keep that in mind, I guess.
I mean, like, both of your choices are great, but, like... the thing with the Ivory King is it's the final one of Dark Souls 2 DLC... I don't count the whole the new Dark Souls 2 special edition shitty thing coming out, but like the Ivory King is essentially imagine up to this point, you had an idea of the certain enemy of the Dark Souls 2 series, the Sisters of the Shadow, or the Sisters of Darkness. You've known how they would act. They're evil people. Everything comes on down to that. Then the Ivory King comes along and literally punches you in the stomach and turns your whole perception of the storyline upside down at that point.
Nice.
On top of the fact that you are essentially in a snow wasteland of a castle that's about the size of a mini city, and just horrific snow creatures are just going all around you. You can't even see some of them because they've actually become one with the snow, so you can't even attack them until a certain point. On top of the fact that also there's a blizzard going on that actually changes when you manage to stop it and changes the whole level around.
Wow.
It is absolutely ridiculous, and from a lore point of view, without even spoiling it, the ending, it just makes you go, wow. Did that really just happen? Like, that doesn't make sense, but it does. But oh, and the final boss of it was absolutely one of the most epic entrances and battlefields of a Dark Souls boss I've ever seen.
Nice.
So yeah, it sounds like for as far as DLC that like actually introduces a lot of interesting new concepts, that sounds pretty up there.
Yeah.
Damn right.
I went with Diablo 3 Reaper of Souls because it completely reinvigorated and changed the game. There were a lot of not very arguably broken things about Diablo, a lot of things people didn't really enjoy. And this DLC brought a lot of things back and also changed a lot and just made people get very much more reinterested in the game and actually kind of make the game what it was supposed to be when it launched. But I'll bow out to Dark Souls because that's a bringing in intense, like, just matching intense gameplay mechanics with lore is a very impressive thing and a hard thing to do. I always enjoy the way Dark Souls combines gameplay and world interaction is very interesting.
Yeah.
Ooh, yay! And obviously, I'm not even saying that Diablo doesn't do that well, because obviously the story in Diablo, well, to us, well, me at least, I enjoy the story of Diablo. I think it's cool. And the gameplay is, of course, still great. Let's face it, we've grown up with that. We love it. The only problem I had with the end of Diablo was the ending essentially makes you go, like, you're really going to do that to us again, huh, Diablo? But I still enjoyed it very much, though.
So Shadowrun Dragonfall was... it was cool to me just because I liked Shadowrun Returns a lot, and it was more of that, and I thought it was cool. But I would definitely bow out to Dark Souls DLC because I've just heard so many good things. All right, so that's it. Dark Souls 2, The Ivory King is the best DLC of 2014 then. And then on to the last category for day one. This one caused a little bit of confusion last year, but we're all on the same page now. Don't worry, guys at home. This is the best overlooked game from last year, from 2013. So which games did you might not have noticed or, you know, maybe didn't get enough time to play last year that you discovered this year? Chris?
Well, right, like, as I was saying before, Nick, before we start recording, me and you actually talked about this a good amount, but we really didn't find it until the end, and I didn't have time to play it until now. But I got to say Mars Wars Log.
Oh, nice. Okay.
Yeah. This is more – I didn't know the your logic behind this category. I looked through all the things that won last year, and I looked at the games that came out last year, and the game that I saw that didn't get any awards that we gave it that I think deserves a bunch of credit that people should play it. It just didn't happen to win any awards. Is Dust and Elysian Tale didn't win last year, didn't win anything.
Wow, I'm surprised.
Right? Of how much we love that game, I was reminded because it was re-released for PS4 as one of the free games, and it didn't win anything. And I'm like, holy crap! How could we not talk about Dust?
No, I have an answer for that. It's because it came out in 2012, and it did win awards in 2012.
Oh yeah, he's right, actually.
All right, going back. So I thought I might be wrong about this. So
I prepared a second one.
I did prepare a second one. Gears of War Judgment. I thought it was very good.
Oh, okay.
I don't think that game got enough praise because I think it's actually the best Gears of War game that came out, to be in my opinion.
Wow.
Wow, that's a heavy claim.
I mean, I'll defend it in a moment, but keep going.
All right, so mine is a game that we showed off on Steampunks. It came out on Steam this year. but it had actually been released on Xbox Live Indie Games last year, and that's Mount Your Friends. That game, I played it a lot this year, so I feel like it deserves something. So, yeah, Chris, Mars Warlogs. That game was cool when we showed it off on Steampunks. I liked it.
Right, yeah, like, it's very Witcher-esque playing, except obviously in space, because it's on Mars. But, I mean, when you overlook the fact of how atrocious the voice acting was the first time around before they updated it, which I still love to listen to because it's just so funny at that point. It's like old-school Resident Evil. It's a very well-made game that nobody knew existed, like, at all, except for the horrible voice acting. But the gameplay was very much of Witcher-esque. You go around, talk with people, you're applying to try and get off this Mars prison, and in my opinion, it's very well done. I don't know what to back down for, because Judgment was good, but Mount Your Friends, just for the sake of that game exists.
I might have to know about it.
Exactly.
I think that a lot of the, I feel like every Gears of War game was leading up to Judgment, and I feel like a lot of people, like, just in terms of gameplay, like, the story was okay, it was good. The Gears of War story, you don't play it for the story. But
I do.
Many people don't play for the story. We play weird, very weird games. So, I just, making it, the balance between going behind cover and coming out of cover, and, like, the balance of getting you out of cover, that Gears of War trope of just hiking behind chest-high walls, and the verticality, and they added color into the game. It was just, it seems like they listened to everything anyone ever complained about with Gears of War and put it into the game in a positive way and made the game better because of all of it. And I just remember playing Gears Judgment and just, like, being very happy. I'm like, this is the Gears game that I've always wanted, and it's very good, and why is not everyone playing this game?
All right. Mount Your Friends is... How do you describe Mount Your Friends, really?
all you need to say is just Mount Your Friends is Mount Your Friends, and I think we're done.
That's pretty much it. I emailed them, Mount Your Friends guy. I'm going to try to talk to him soon.
I mean, so Mount Your Friends, that, like, for anybody who hasn't seen it, I guess, it's like a... It defies explanation, but yeah, it's like you're trying to climb high, and so you stack yourselves on top of each other, and you're all very burly men in swimsuits or speedos or whatever, and they have a big member that swings around as you swing, and then you climb as high as you can, and then somebody wins, and that's it.
If you want a deeper look, check out the Steampunks episode where me and Nick look way too deep into this game.
We get really into the lore, the backstory of Mount Your Friends. But no, it's just like a party game that is really, it's good for any situation. Like, I have busted that game out so many times just, like, with, you know, people over, and it, no matter what, like, it's always fun. And, yeah, I mean, for that reason, it's just, like, something that it's probably the game from 2013 that I played the most this year, for sure. But, I think it deserves a lot of recognition.
I'm prepared to bow out for that a game that deserves a lot more spotlight than it did. I mean, people played Gears of War Judgment, of course. It's a Gears of War game. But a game that literally was over, I think it fits the category better. So I'm prepared to bow out Gears of War to burly, and it does still have to deal with burly men fighting each other, which Gears of War
stands. They're basically
the
same game, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's the same thing. It's the same
Gears
thing.
Gears of War stole from Mount Your Friends.
That's it.
So is it Mount Your Friends versus Mars Warlogs now?
No, I bowed out long ago to Mount Your Friends.
Well, then Mount Your Friends it is.
Yay!
That game is really weird, and fun test for you guys at home. Try to describe this game to your friends. I'm sure it'll work out very well.
And not lose your friends.
Yeah, right?
Yeah, it's a weird game, and it's really no way to describe it without sounding like an idiot. So, yeah. That's going to do it for day one of our Game of the Year stuff for 2014. What year is it? It's 2014.
What year is it?
Keep tuning in, guys. There's going to be 4 more days of this stuff all this week. Keep checking PressPlayTV.com for that stuff. You can listen to this. You're probably listening to this now in podcast form, but we also have an article that talks about these games, so make sure to check that stuff out. You'll probably be hearing more of us as this week goes on, but to you, Pete and Chris, thanks for joining.
Always an honor. Cool. Thank you for having.
Good times.
And until tomorrow, can't say keep it steamy, but happy holidays. Keep it yearly. I don't like that at all.
Yeah, I'd say that feels.
I don't like keep it steamy at all. So
that's just because you didn't come up with it.
Oh, I feel icky now.
All right, guys. Bye.
The bad touch.